Our devastating little scheme will begin with my freeze ray. Come!
What's up, everybody? This is the CCD Podcast. We've got all your cultural compulsive disorders covered. We are here on this very, very steamy New York City day in a very special location, the Suckhole. Joining me today, the Sucklord himself. What's going on?
Hello.
What's going on, big guy? Thanks
You're
so much.
In my space, taking up my time, so make it worth my while.
All right. And our good old friend, Amit Saxena, joining us.
Howdy.
One of my resident nerd expert friends. Thanks so much for having us here.
We'll see about that. I'll thank you at the end.
That's fine. You don't have to thank me, but I do have to thank you.
Okay, for sure. Fine. You're welcome.
So, we're here to talk to you, the Sucklord, about a little bit about what you've going on. We've been familiar with your work for a long time, more than 15 years now. And I think that's roughly about how long you've been doing this, a little bit longer than that. I think you started a little bit late 90s, right? Sort of professionally.
Depends on what you want to call the beginning. I usually mark it at Star Wars Breakbeats.
Yeah. Which was, what was that, 98?
96 really was when the cassette came out. 98-ish was when I officially released it and it became popular.
And I think we first met you on the Star Wars line for the first Star Wars Episode One.
Yeah, those were the days.
That was so at that point, I think when we first saw you, we heard people referring to you as Ghetto Fett. Was that a real thing or was that just what people made up?
I did not coin that phrase. Yeah. I was using the name Super Genius at the time to describe
what I did. That's right.
That's what's on the back of the CD.
Yeah, but because I was wearing a sort of hip-hopified Mandalorian outfit, specifically a customized Boba Fett gear, it just was a pretty easy derivative kind of descriptive from I don't really know anything about hip-hop kind of way.
Right, sure.
You know, to equate hip-hop with the ghetto is it's some people consider that to be somewhat of a derogatory term.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I don't give a shit because I sold a lot of stuff.
Yeah, no kidding, man. And you've sort of that character has existed and still sort of changed. You've changed that outfit a little bit, but it's that's where it all sort of was born out
pretty
of, right?
Much. I mean, I had actually been doing Fett cosplay since 79. I did Boba Fett based on his appearance on the holiday special. Sweet. And the mail-away figure for the Halloween parade that used to go through the West Village over here. And I did that for 3 years in a row.
With a different color scheme?
The original one was the Ben Cooper costume, right, with the mask, with the rubber band and just that weird plastic suit. But I customized it. I put like tin foil on the back to make an enclosing helmet. And I had a belt and I had a shoebox that I made into the jetpack. Weirdly enough, that original Don Post mask was silver, which was not the accurate color Boba Fett's mask. But now I have the latest incarnation of the Sucklord helmet is silver. So right. I'm wondering on some level if it's been influenced by that, because I've always used Fett as a way to bolster my identity. Yeah. You know, when I was a kid, I was kind of a shy, little, small, nerdy kid, and identifying with Boba Fett and trying to embody Boba Fett gave me a certain amount of confidence when I had the mask on.
Cool.
And I revisited that when I became an adult. And, the new Star Wars movies came out, and I used this character mm-hmm. to make myself appear to be more than I really was.
You got a couple other helmets, right? Don't you? A few personas.
It's expanded a little bit, yes. There's other characters, original characters.
Yeah.
Well, I was forced when I started making my own independent films. There's always the underlying concern that if you lean too heavily on Star Wars, you're going to have a hard time developing your own IP. So it's great to vault yourself into some sort of cultural relevancy, because it's an easily recognizable language that all of us in this demographic and even other demographics can recognize, and you can use it as the building blocks to make sort of original personal artistic statements. But at some point, you're going to have to pull it back if you want to sell something original.
Right, sure. Yeah, I mean, just looking around, I mean, when I was first seeing your stuff, it was very much Star Wars heavy. And there's obviously still a lot of Star Wars going on, but you got all kinds of pop culture influences and different action figure lines and all sorts of just everything, magazines, and it's branched out. These large format ones I've been noticing you've been doing lately are really cool. Is that sort of what you've kind of been focusing on lately?
Yeah, a little bit. I think increasing, like I've come up with a pretty noticeable style. I've been doing the classic 3 3/4 blister carded package, which is, of course, burned into my brain and my aesthetic because of the, you know, when I was buying, I've been buying Star Wars figures since 1978. So that's just a configuration that's always worked for me as far as being a just endlessly usable palette for conveying ideas. And I've done it to death. I've done hundreds and hundreds of things. And to me, the next step seemed to just make them bigger, especially if I want to do it on like a fine art, mm-hmm. in quotes,
sure.
tip, because my experiences with, you know, going into the fine art world is that people tend to buy artwork by the square foot.
Interesting. So you're a New York City native.
Yeah.
Right? Born and raised.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just that's like us, you know, CCD, we're all New York City based, and you've continued to maintain a presence here in the city, and like that's been important to you, kind of
particularly down here on the Lower East, right?
Yeah, we're sort of in Chinatown right now, or what's slowly not becoming Chinatown. I mean, it's been the whole downtown area is being completely just overrun by just development and douchebaggery and hipsters and fancy this and foo-foo that and all the sort of gritty edge to it that I'm used to from growing up here in the 70s and 80s is almost essentially completely disappeared from Manhattan.
I was surprised even that you were able to still maintain this spot held on to it.
Well, that depends on how many people continue to buy stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's never a guarantee. You know, paying for something like this, it's not cheap. People think it's cheap down here, and it may be a little bit cheaper, but not really. We're somewhere on Canal Street on the east side. I have to sell constantly in order to...
I can
to
only imagine, dude. Like, cheaper compared to what, you know? Like, maybe you could get some
five
other...
5 blocks uptown.
Yeah.
10 blocks uptown, East Village, the upper Lower East Side. We're sort of getting into the lower East Side here, but it's pretty much gone. They're opening a fucking Ace Hotel over here. Yeah, they're like one of these old high rises that have been laid fallow, these older buildings from back when this was, you know, more of a thriving area back in the 30s, 40s, whatever.
You know, it's interesting because people come to these areas and like it because it has that sort of gritty, like artistic presence.
And then there's too many of them and they fuck it up.
And then, you
or
know,
they make money and then
they start opening Barnes & Nobles and shit like that. And like,
I take a Barnes & Noble over some of the crap that they got going here.
I completely hear you. I mean, Brooklyn's gone through a ton of that shit too. And just like, you come here because the neighborhood is a certain way and then you change the neighborhood. So, you know.
Well, it's not you. It's always the guy after you that fucked it up.
Well,
of course. You had a reason to be there because you're part of the city and you're adding something cultural to it, whereas the next guy fucked it up.
And you hear guys waxing nostalgic about, like, you know, 2005 in the city sort of thing. And I'm
it's
like,
odd like that. I mean, to be honest with you, I think, like, the mid to late 90s was really a golden era because the dangerous aspect, like, all the Lower East Side was just a war zone for drug dealers.
Right, sure.
And then that ended. Giuliani crushed those guys, thankfully, because then this whole area opened up, but it wasn't developed, and you could be an artist, you can be a small businessman, you know, have some sort of creative thing and set up down here and be able to make it. And that's always the beginning of the end. Like, once the art, like, you know, this is the cliche, but the artists reclaim these derelict neighborhoods, make it cool, and then the development comes and the artists get pushed out.
There's
and
money
the
there.
Original people that lived here get pushed out.
And then you've got
the meatpacking district.
I don't know what you've got then. People from Ohio doing something. I don't know.
I mean, it's usually Dutch people, I think. I think it's Germans and Dutch people who just build up these places.
Really?
That's what it is. I mean, at least that's what I know. And that's the kind of work they start with, the, you know, the big time buildings in Midtown. And when they can't get those anymore, then they just start buying up this stuff because they know eventually it's
going
to be.
There's a lot of Chinese money going around too. Big investments, not only in Chinatown, but all over the place. There's just a lot of people, like one company owns like every building on this block.
Yeah.
So like this corner of pop art or what we want to call it.
I think that's a fair term.
I don't think that there's anybody doing what you're doing, sort of thing. There's lots of pop art, obviously. It's even now more than ever in a certain way. It's a lot of like mashup t-shirts you see right. for sale and shit like that. But I remember when I first saw your stuff in 99 and being blown away by it and thinking it was so unique. And even still, as far as everything's come, I think your stuff is still super unique. And I mean, nobody does it the way that you do it. It's and you don't, you're still not quite cranking things out. You're not mass producing things in the way that other things are. But everything that I see that you have has a is unique in its own way and has a little bit of a personal touch of the Sucklord on it. Has that been something you've strive to like have or just sort of come that way? Or?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, obviously, if you're going to make work, you want it to be original and you want people to recognize it as your own. I don't know if that's something that you can manufacture if it doesn't exist already. I just sort of do what I do and it comes out the way it does. I am not the only person doing stuff like this.
Sure.
I was one of the first guys, if not the first, to make these sort of mashup figures and do these small runs of resin productions with molds and stuff like that. Up until that time, a lot of independent toy makers were still going through Chinese factories and making rotocast vinyl and
right.
doing 1,000-piece editions. And I couldn't even crack into that world. I've been trying to make toys since before high school.
Right.
And when I got out of college, I was trying to shop around an idea for the Action Crack House playset that I developed. I had no idea where to go. I went to Art Asylum. There's no way like Hasbro would make something like that. You don't even have any way to get in there. And then this designer toy movement came about with like all those Hong Kong guys like Michael Lau and Eric So and 360 Toy Group making. They had their connections in China and they were able to make artist toys in factories, but they were still low-run boutique things, and I couldn't even get into that world, so I was forced to make things on my own using mold-making stuff you could buy at the art supply store.
Right.
You know, you talk about nostalgia and going back. I mean, you mentioned that you were really the first one to do this, and coming back, and you just think about how things have changed, obviously, over the years, and the internet, and how somebody wants to do this, they can figure out how to do this.
Well, there's dozens of people doing this now.
But back then, I think for those of us who, you know, got into your stuff early, you know, it was just like, this stuff exists, you know? I mean, we're still early.
Well, yeah, how did you figure out, like, how to make a fucking toy?
Yeah.
Like, you could Google it now and probably figure something out, but, like, you just figured it out.
Kind of. I mean, I knew that such supplies existed. I mean, you can buy silicone and casting resin in an art supply store. I knew that was doable, and a friend of mine was playing around with that stuff, so I just saw him do it. I was like, oh, this, I can make like 10, 15, 20 figures with this crap,
right?
And it's not going to break the bank. So I did it, and the thing about these materials that you don't always get perfect results. It has certain flaws to it. A lot of the toys come out, or the pieces come out a little rough or with little air bubbles, or they don't all look the same. The colors can be off. So I was like, fuck this shit. This isn't going to work unless I make their fuck-ups part of the brand, part of the aesthetic.
The genius
really
of the
Sucklord. I don't know if it was genius. It was just sort of desperation. It's like, I've got to make money. I was living with my mom, and I took an art studio, and that was like the first time I ever had to pay like real rent on anything. It's like, fuck, I have to, and I'm completely unemployable. So it's like, if this stuff doesn't make any money, I'm fucked already. So it's either throw these in the garbage or start over or figure out how to sell this shit.
Right.
But I mean, that's what you want, right? When you're buying art, you want to kind of bring home the artist with you, right? That's what you want. So you get something imperfect and you're like, okay, this came from this
guy.
If
you want to bring me home, it's extra.
Right, okay.
But I know
what
you're saying.
We'll negotiate later. But yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you see that in poster art too now. They, you know, people sell imperfections and they sell them for more than the original run was going for.
People do like that hands-on stuff. Yeah. You know, when people generally look to this kind of stuff when they've had enough of buying mass-produced things. They still want the adventure and the experience of buying a Star Wars figure, but they want a little extra edge on it.
Yeah.
Well, like, I love collecting toys growing up. I bought all kinds of toys that as I've grown, I a little bit more classy, I guess, maybe for lack of a better term, in my collection, is I want things that are very unique. Just buying a toy off the rack in Toys R Us of Darth Vader isn't doing it for me anymore. So that's one of the reasons I love your stuff, because everything is unique. And you know, sometimes we do art shows with our group, and we sell prints of them, but I'm always like, I want the original. Right. The original is what I want, because that's the thing that the artist touched. And that's what's really cool about your things. Like, I know you touched everything.
Why does that matter?
It's like a tangible connection to it. Like,
why do you need feeling. To connect at all?
I don't know. That's what art means to me, I guess. And that's where, you know, I get the enjoyment out of it, in a way, I guess, knowing that an artist worked on something hard, and now, you know, I'm able to, that energy is part of it, I think, maybe almost held in it in a way, or some shit.
Good. I'm glad you feel that way. Because a lot of people do, and I'd be out of business if they didn't.
Yeah.
Sometimes being the person that makes this stuff, I don't see the magic in it.
Right. Mm-hmm. Sure. Of course.
And I don't necessarily have those impulses. Like, I don't get high off my own supply, as it were. So I don't buy art. I don't collect art. I barely collect anything. I don't like things, period.
Okay.
I don't like stuff. But
that's interesting.
But I need to know why people do, so I know how to make the right stuff, so I can make sure that the stuff that I make is successful.
And what we've seen in, you know, artists like, you know, Mondo is a big company that does these custom movie posters and stuff, and that sort of thing, where that appeals maybe to an older collector who's still sort of into that thing and maybe has a little bit more of a disposable income and wants something a little bit more unique. And I think you bring that big time. You know, big time. And
I mean, you can't underestimate the nostalgia side of it, too. I mean, the medium that you're working in. When you touch something that looks like what you touched when you were a kid, but it's different and interesting, I mean, it just kind of brings a whole different level to it.
Yeah, I'm always a little touchy about using the term nostalgia as a selling point, because I understand what that means. But in a lot of ways, I think, you know, nostalgia is trying to go back or trying to relive something that's over. At least what I think I'm trying to do is sort of make a new experience, but have it just be tactily and sort of intellectually akin to prior experiences that you had as a kid. But you're not necessarily trying to go back and be a kid. You're being an adult, and this is just sort of a continuation of what you've always been into. It's just taking place in the present, and it appeals to a different sensibility because you're a more older, seasoned person.
That's a great way to say it. And we've talked briefly about this before. Like, one of the things I dig about your whole thing is that it's not a nostalgia trip, and it's not about any sort of, there's no derogatoriness to it, like lame nerd geek sort of a thing that you're kind of trying to exploit. I was always, you know, when I met you, I'm like, that guy's cool. Like, he's a cool guy. And, like, you know, I always thought I was sort of cool.
No.
That's a geek sort of culture that I've always felt is that I'm in. But, like, mainstream, it's always about they're nerds. They don't get laid. They do this. They do that.
I mean, that's a pretty tired stereotype. I mean, it's true, and it does apply to certain people. But I've always pushed against that as far as how I branded myself. It's like, I don't think there's anything appealing about a sort of socially maladjusted person that never gets laid and sort of lives in his mom's basement. I mean, I lived with my mom till I was 36 fucking years old, but I was bringing girls home all the time.
Right.
And I was working hard trying to make something of myself. Right. And I was partying and I was taking drugs and I was going out and doing shit. So I wasn't, you know, and I had fucking friends. I wasn't some loser. I also jerked off a lot, but, you know.
Sure.
But I've always pushed back against that. And that's what I always think was partially what was successful about what I did. It's like, here's all these geeks standing around in traditional Star Wars costumes, and here's this fucking guy, and he's all hip hop, and there's girls around him. What the fuck?
That's what I
want to identify with that, because I'm a fully fledged person. I'm not a fucking loser because I like this stuff, and I've always just never bought into that.
And there is an audience for that, and I think, you know, I'm part of that, and there are guys who are into that, and, like, we don't want to be ashamed. Because it's not a matter of shame.
There's nothing to be ashamed of.
You know?
We're actually having more fun than you standing over there trying to be fucking too cool.
Exactly.
Fuck you.
Exactly. So that's been really cool that you've kept that vibe from the moment I met you and, you know, up until this moment. It's that same sort of, like, this is me, this is what I fucking do.
If you don't fucking like it, I'll work with you.
if you buy something.
If you buy something, I'm sure we have something that fits your price point.
So we opened up with that track that was off of 1 year old, the Supervillains album that I love. It hasn't left my iPod since
really?
You put it out. Yeah, dude, I still really dig it.
Yeah.
And I know music was, that was part of the thing you were doing back then. You haven't had much going on lately.
I did the music before the toys.
Right.
There was a brief period of time when they were working together. It was always the vision that there was going to be, again, going back to Star Wars, what was so great about it was like, here's the film, the sort of centerpiece of this experience, and then all the little different things you can fucking buy right. that goes along with it. And I was always trying to recreate that as a music performer. Here's my album, and then here's all the toys, and then there's videos or whatever. But things being what they are, being a one-man show, it's hard to do all of that stuff
tell
together.
Me about it, yeah.
And this was right at the beginning of the downloading age, right. and it was just like, for a while, I was just selling physical copies of these CDs like fucking crazy.
Right.
And then over a course of maybe a year or two after people started downloading it and iTunes and all that, done, over, right. no money. And I stopped doing it.
So there's no point. There's no point in doing it anymore, I guess.
At some point, I mean, we've got tons of music backed up. I've been doing musical things since then. It's just we've never put any of it out because of the development time. Right. And it's just not enough. We haven't really figured out the model how to make money off of it, especially also when you're sampling stuff and not clearing it. It's just, it gets
dicey.
We haven't quite figured out how to put the music out yet in a way that makes sense. If the artwork was making more money and I didn't have to work quite as hard at it, I'd have time to do the music, and the music can act as sort of a promotional arm to the product.
Right.
But it's just not quite there yet.
And I think you've talked about the music, like, you know, doing samples is sort of, you know, that's sort of the toy thing. It was like sampling songs in hip hop, but like you were sampling toys.
Yeah, we're sampling toys now. It's a similar approach. These are all remixes or mixtapes or whatever.
Like,
you know,
what's
all
cooler than that?
I don't know. Probably plenty of them.
I'm telling you, it's pretty cool.
I mean, I've always felt that no matter what I was making, whether it was a toy, a song, or a video, or doing a show, they were all kind of the same thing. They were all coming from there's the same approach to all of those things.
Right.
You know, it's all coming from the same sort of, the same universe.
You said you don't collect a lot personally, but are there other, like, pop artists or anybody that you think are cool out there? Aside from yourself and your place in it, is there a pop art scene that you think is worthwhile?
I guess. I mean, I'm kind of interested in the street art world. Not so much because I love the work so much per se. There's a lot of interesting stuff out there, although there's a lot of it. It's more I'm sort of fascinated with the phenomena of it and just what it's become and how people react to it and how really that's the hot movement right now. That's where the people, I guess, are looking for. There's something dangerous and crude and raw and a little wrong about it, and people want that. People love rebels. They love people that go against the establishment, and that's totally perfectly well embodied in street art. And it's just so funny watching them always trying to commodify it, trying to take something that's
the next step always
essentially unsellable and make it sellable. It's like I people argue about. Is a legal wall really street art? Like, if someone gives you permission, the entire criteria of your approach is different. You can take your time. You can bring all the paint you want. You can bring a scaffold. You can bring lights. You don't have to run away. You have all the time in the world. Where if you're doing something without permission, the restraints of the having to climb somewhere dangerous and having to run from cops and having to worry about other graffiti guys kicking your ass because you're going over their shit, all those restrictions influences the aesthetic of the work. Right. That's why a lot of it looks very quick and dashed, and somehow trying to put that in a can and sell it on a shelf. I find it fascinating watching people how they go through that.
And yeah, I mean, I hope everyone has success.
Right.
But yeah,
you want them to be successful.
It does sort of take
as
away
an artist, but
takes away a little bit. You know, necessity. You know, necessity is the mother of invention, right? So. If you got to hustle, then you're going to create something.
I mean, that's what happens. That's the story of all artists in some way, shape, or form. The question is, when they make money, do they lose something? You know, people always ask that about artists. You know, do they still have that drive when they were, you know, fighting for it?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no. I guess it depends on what the individual situation is. I mean, George Lucas is a pretty good example, I think, of what happens when you can make a movie in absolute comfort. Whereas when instead of having to almost literally kill yourself to get it made,
yeah,
it did make a difference in the Star Wars films. then again, you look at guys like Jeff Koons and Damien Hirst and guys like that. They've got millions and millions and millions of dollars, yet they still make big, ambitious stuff. So I don't know. I don't know if that's a calculation. Like, does all, and I don't even know if that's good art.
Right.
I know it sells, but I don't know if it's good.
Right.
I mean, pop art, guys like the pop vinyl stuff, that's sort of like, I feel like a mainstream.
Like the Funko stuff?
Yeah, yeah. I feel like that's sort of, those guys sort of have an ancillary relationship to sort of kind of what you're doing, but they've like sold it big time. Like, that shit's in Toys R Us.
I don't know, to be honest with you. Yeah.
Mashups in general, I feel like, is...
There's no mashups going on there, is there?
No, no. But just in general, that sort of thing. Like, there was... That word didn't exist, I don't think, when you were starting to do it. But someone could come in here and look and be say, like, this is... You're like a mashup artist, but...
That's for sure. Like, just take anything from anywhere and just put it all together without having a concern about clearing the license or even if it makes any sense or having to sell thousands and thousands of units. Those guys... It's just a licensing company,
yeah,
and they just happen to have a platform that people think is attractive.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah,
I was in a comic book shop the other day, and like a whole fucking wall was just those things.
Right.
And they had everything I could think of. You know, Hannibal Lecter, yes. You know, Iron Man, yes.
Anything cool in
holy
movies,
shit.
TV, pop culture has found or is going to find its way into that line. And people eat it up.
No matter how minuscule of a thing it was in there, sort of.
If it has any sort of fan base, they're going to make it or try to make it. But at the end of the day, it's still, even though it's a very sort of small stylized character, it's not really transformational. It's still just a representation of the thing. There's no like taking this thing from here and this thing from here and putting them together and making it something more than just the sum of the
those
two
guys,
parts.
They got like one mold basically and they just paint them a little bit differently.
Yeah, I'm not knocking it. I just...
No.
I don't think it's art.
Yeah.
It's pop culture.
Yeah.
They're cool
it's
toys.
It's a toy, right?
It's a toy,
It's a toy line. It's like Lego doing a Lego version of something.
Right. It's not striving to be anything other than what it is on its face value.
Right.
Well, you must run into criticism, I guess. I mean...
No. Yeah, all the time.
What about... You know, if somebody comes to a show and they give you shit, does that happen? Do people do that or not really?
No. To my face, no. Or I've had people tell me they don't specifically care for it, or I've read things online, but I don't know. I don't really necessarily take into account the more vitriolic or personal, just sort of knee-jerk reactions to things. Most people who look at this shit and hate it are pretty probably just looking at it on the surface and just having an immediate reaction. And sometimes it's against me because I also have a personality that not everybody appreciates. And yeah, you could look at this stuff and say, oh, well, this is very lazy. He's just writing Star Wars. He just took a He-Man figure, put a fucking Sleestak head on it, called it LSD, and that's it. Big deal. Where's the creativity there? And I mean, I don't know if I can necessarily argue against that. You know, yeah, it might not be very... It's not necessarily the same thing as a excellent painter taking a paintbrush and painting something completely imaginary and making it look beautiful and realistic. I don't know if those two things are equivalent. They're not supposed to be, but I can see, I usually agree with people when they have well-reasoned critiques against it.
Well, I've always liked that you've had that attitude. And I think it's a very good attitude to have because art is very subjective. And, you know, I've always been fascinated, like as a consumer of art, like the art that I don't like, it's okay if I don't like it. I'm always fascinated by people who like they hate something.
Yeah.
They're like, this shouldn't be a thing. And it's like, who gives a shit?
Yeah, really.
What does it matter to you? And I wonder if as an artist, like, do you even sort of like eliciting a hateful reaction maybe? Because you're getting anything.
Yeah. There's people that have been mad and just said that it shouldn't exist. And this asshole shouldn't be making as much money as he's making doing the thing that he does. And I love that shit. I really love that
For
shit.
For real.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, they love it too. They don't think they love it, but the fact that it's giving them something to grind on and something to obsess upon and something to stoke their passions, even if it drives them to do the opposite, they like it. I mean, there's been people, and I've seen things in the world that I've thought was crap.
Sure.
And it pushes me to want to be better than that.
Sure.
So you're welcome.
But yeah, it always fascinates me how much energy people will put into hating something.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And I'm just like, I don't have
worse,
fucking time for that.
Look, it's worse in the nerd world, you know that.
Oh yeah, it's the worst. And go on and on. Yeah.
I always say that if you don't have haters, you're doing something wrong.
It's a great point, man.
You're not provoking any reaction in anybody.
You know, it's very unlikely that you're going to get any sort of strong love without strong hate. Yeah. You know, you want both, I guess.
That's about right.
What about like 3D printing? Have you investigated that at all? Or I mean, it's becoming more and more consumer friendly. People are printing toys at home and things like that.
Yeah, I haven't really. I know all about it. I know what it is. I think it's fascinating and pretty incredible technology. I haven't really found a very extensive way to involve it in my work per se. Like I don't have the technical patience to really design in that world.
It's computer based, right? It's a lot of computer
You have to scan objects or draw objects in 3D, and it's like I can't. I'm not good at that kind of stuff. I have used it here and there, and it's going to be useful in the future. I mean, one thing that we're doing with was trying to make larger versions of all of these characters that I've done, and the best way to do it is just take the figure, scan it, you know, blow it up digitally, and then print it, you know, a 2-up or a 4-up, and then make a mold of that piece. It's like people have not quite mastered the price point of being actually able to manufacture a run of things all 3D printed. It still takes a little too long to print it. It could be a little costly if you want good quality. Like molding and stuff like that for mass production runs still seems to be more economical. That being said, the thing is, if your toy exists as a 3D model, you don't have to sell any of them. You just sell the file or give the file away.
That's pretty crazy.
That's a slippery slope, right?
That's a whole different thing.
But I mean,
you're going down Napster route again, I guess.
Kind of, but I mean, I think at least people that are real aficionados and hobbyists in the world of 3D printing, that's the appeal to them, that like you can create something, post it, share it, someone else can take it, put their own spin on it, print it out, put it back up, and then people can pass it around.
Then it becomes meaningful.
Then it's interesting. Yeah. There's nobody making money off of that, but it's fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe you can sell a toy for less money and someone can just print it at home, I guess is the idea. But if that appeals to somebody.
Yeah, but then what's to stop him from printing more of them?
Oh, of course. And part of the thing I like about your stuff is the packaging and the whole style. The whole thing as a package is what is the art. And I wouldn't just want the figure sort of thing. I need the whole package. That's why I still buy records sometimes. You know, I like having a physical thing. And, you know, maybe we're the end of that generation.
I don't know about that because, you know, vinyl records were dead for a minute and now they've come back.
It's not just us,
niche,
right?
Though. It's not just
it can't
us.
Be, right?
But it's a niche. That's the
thing. It's definitely a niche. Yeah. It's not mainstream. But I definitely know there's a lot of younger kids who never grew up going to record stores who are now getting the same sort of excitement feeling for going and digging in crates and stuff like that. You know, I always think that you're right in a way. You're never going to fully replace the pleasure of an object.
I think that it exists. I mean, I know it's because we grew up with it, but I think that's a natural thing that people have. And, you know, there's different ways to collect digital as well, which are very cool too. But this is why I as a collector, my collections have been a little bit more high brow or high value sort of thing, because I don't buy as much little shit, but I buy a couple of big things.
Right.
So I want them to be really cool and unique sort of thing. And I think there are collectors like that out there who are into that sort of thing.
Yeah, old people.
It's not just us. It's not just old people.
No, you're right. It is. And kids, some kids are smart, right? What do you see when you interact? Do you see mostly people our age or do you see younger people?
Mostly people are our age, people in 30s, 40s, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Kids like this shit, as far as I know. I've had plenty of kids come around and look at it and think it's fun and maybe even want to make their own little thing. But as far as wanting to actually collect, not so much.
Yeah.
Not so much. Although I know they do. I mean, but kids are so into the digital entertainment now, the video games and all, and the apps and the stuff and iPads and stuff like that.
Well, that's obviously what you have to do next is make the Sucklord video.
The Suck app or something.
It's in the ether somewhere.
It's in the ether. So yeah, do you have any projects going on? I know you've been still cranking these out and doing these large format things, and I know you've been on a couple of TV shows here and there and things like that. What's the current state of the Sucklord?
I'm trying to push into entertainment. I'm also developing a podcast of my own that touches on the stuff we're talking here now, but also delves heavily into sex and dating and drugs
right.
and things of that nature as well. And it's my understanding or my is that, you know, there's money to be made in that world as well. And
really?
Yeah. Yeah. If you get to a certain level, and, you know, I have ambitions to go back on television and use what, even if I'm not necessarily making a shitload of money off making a podcast, definitely think that if it becomes popular, it can make some money, but it also serves as just a commercial for the product.
Right.
Brian. It's like right now, just heavily relying on the product to not only sell itself on its own merits, but bear all the weight of the cash flow, the inward cash flow, is becoming harder and harder to sustain. And I think having, you know, another outlet that complements it will hopefully lift everything else up. Doing this kind of shit is hard. We have a much more complicated system than right. you guys have. But
I think that was a diss, but I'm not.
That's
sure.
all right.
No, it's not. It's not a diss. I'm just saying it's. This is pretty compact and streamlined.
Yeah, no, you're trying to put together just, like a TV show.
It's a little bit more like a TV show. I mean, we are all just sitting around in this room doing the same right. thing we're doing now, but we have more people. We have one camera per person.
Right.
And we're doing live switching.
That's awesome.
That is awesome.
It's awesome.
That's real.
Yeah, we're getting there.
You were like maybe some animated bits in there or different sorts of production stuff.
Yeah, and we have music and stuff like
that.
Very
cool.
But then also it's a job unto itself, not only just producing it, but then like maintaining all your digital presence, keeping up on your pages and all that crap. You know, we're going to have it on YouTube and
sure.
Stitcher and SoundCloud and all that stuff. And just having to just service it on that end is also time consuming as well.
It takes forever.
I mean, I really need a staff of people.
Right.
But you can't hire people
they
until
need
you
money.
Make money. Yeah,
yeah
so
they need
that's
money.
Always that weird little donut hole you fall into where you may very well have something that has potential to make money. You just need other people to help do it, but you can't pay them until you make money, and you can't make money until you hire people, so you fucking figure it out.
And you explored for a while. You had a small retail store, right?
Yeah.
For public people to come in.
Yeah.
And is that still around? Or
no.
Is it, and
it was a pop-up that popped up a little
that's
too
right.
long.
Yeah. And gallery shows still occasionally?
Here and there, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's really cool stuff. And I would love to see you get some more of those
yeah.
going.
Yeah, I have a few things cooking.
What about the music? Is there anywhere you can still hear the music?
To be honest with you, not really. We have another project, this Band of the Lost thing mm-hmm. that we've done for a while. I have my partner, the Crystal Pharaoh, who's done a lot of beats, and he's got a huge catalog, but it's not ready yet. It's going to be one day, but unfortunately it's just one part of the thing that's had to take the back burner.
Sure. Prioritize.
It's difficult, right? I mean, it's you got to kind of really just focus on one thing for a little while and try to perfect that. It's hard, especially when you're doing everything yourself. It's hard to manage everything because then everything almost starts to suffer a little bit if you're trying to
and
work
and you start
too hard.
To suffer too.
That, right.
And the thing is, if you're working too hard and you're not having any fun and you're just still not making money and you can't do the things you want to do because I got to stay home and do this and it's like then you start to be miserable and then that also fucks the work up too.
So you were on a reality competition show for a little while there, right? A few years ago.
I've been on a few TV shows.
Wasn't there was one with Sarah Jessica Parker
yeah,
or something?
Yeah, it was called Work of Art, the Next
That's
Great
the
Artist,
one.
And that was like a Top Chef or Project Runway type competition show on Bravo. But instead of dresses or food, it was fine art.
Right, right. How was that experience? Was it?
It was great.
Yeah, yeah. It was a cool time. Or
yeah, it's fun. I mean, I like doing that kind
I
of stuff.
I feel like that was almost. I feel like that would almost do a little better right now. It might have been just a little bit ahead of its time, or even more specifically, even focusing on, you know, pop art, or even it could have even been a little bit more niche because I didn't even hear about that until. I was looking it up recently. Yeah. It missed some of its target audience, I think.
Something didn't quite click there. It could possibly have been the network that it was on.
Right.
Didn't really know how to service it because it was a bit of an anomaly. It wasn't like Bravo is known for Real Housewives and Project Runway. And
which
those
you
are,
should also be on, by the way.
Yeah, maybe. Right. But those are high drama shows where
right.
they sort of find people that... that have that sort of temperament.
People who will fight with each
people
other.
People will
yeah.
fight right. with each other and melt down. And whatever, the group of people that they found to be the artists on the show that tended to be some kind of mellow, well-meaning people
right.
who all kind of wanted to get along
right.
and support each other. And it still made, I think, for interesting TV, but without the car crash factor,
right.
it didn't attract the viewership.
Sure.
And it got canceled. Also, I think because it's art. Like food, you can relate. Anybody can relate to. Art, not everybody likes art.
Right. You got to like focus on the art, I think. So I watched that show Face Off. Mm-hmm. I don't ever see that. It's on Sci-Fi Channel. They do the movie makeup and movie stuff. Makeup. And pretty much everybody on that usually are very nice. Like they're all nice people and like they get along and they get eliminated. They're like, okay, I had a great time. And there's no drama
but
at all.
But that show's a hit though.
Yeah, that show is a hit.
But it's because of what
they focus
doing.
And they focus on the task and the art and they really get into it, which is appeals to me.
Right. Yeah. It's more of like a procedural, I guess. Where, right. You know, you can don't really care if the guy on the show is in it is excited or not because you think what they're doing is cool.
And I like seeing nice people. I don't usually like seeing assholes, you know, but maybe I'm a minority.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, I think the show, the work of art show was good. It's just, like I said, it might have been on the wrong network. It might have been better on like a Learning Channel or History Channel or something like that. You know, like I was watching Pawn Stars.
Sure.
And the appeal to that is like for people to look at the items and get the history of it.
You would hope.
It's almost like an antique roadshow kind of thing where it's really about the stuff being sold. They try to jazz it up with like
I feel like in these later seasons, it's all about Chumlee. That's all it's all they ever fucking talk about.
Yeah,
I want to see the stuff.
Maybe they feel that they need to have that element in order to make it a true reality show.
I'm sure the people making the decisions are, that's what they're basing there.
Yeah.
Know, what kind of response are we getting? You know, who's tweeting about it or writing about it, you know, tweeting, whatever the kids are doing. But, you know, who's responding to it? Now, what do they respond to? And they see when somebody's being a dick, you know, everybody writes. And so that's what, you know, that's what happens.
You got to do what you got to do to keep people watching.
Yeah. They respond to assholes and anger and that sort of thing. Face Off is cool, though.
Okay.
I will say, though, for me, being on TV was good for business.
I can only imagine, dude.
Unfortunately, the problem with it is, once you're off TV, it goes away. Like, I also had recently a video go viral. I did an interview for a filmmaker named Joey Garfield, and he just pretty much just came to my studio.
I saw it. It was great, yeah.
Filmed me talking while I worked, which was, I don't think is particularly interesting. And I had done literally a dozen of those things since I've been doing this.
Sure.
And none of them did anything. And they were, you know, this one was maybe a little better, but the subject matter was pretty much the same thing. It's just, here I am. I make these bootleg toys. Look at me work. I'm a dirtbag. Whatever. This one, for whatever reason, connected.
Right.
And it got picked. It got elevated by Vimeo, and then it got took off from there. And I sold for about 2 weeks when it was getting literally going viral. I was selling all my back stock, like shit that had been sitting here for months, was flying out the door. It's like, this is fantastic. And then almost instantly it stopped.
Yeah.
It just hit peak exposure and it was done. And then I was back to nothing.
Well, I'm hoping we can do the same for you with this.
I mean, every little bit helps. Yeah.
But it goes into attention span and can anything have the lasting impact? And we can probably even lead this to our discussion about Star Wars. You know, can anything have the lasting impact that things in the past did now that there's so much out there?
Well, there's so much to consume.
You have to keep making more shit.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, we could get into this, but I mean, one of the reasons why Star Wars still continues to be relevant is because they keep making new stuff.
Absolutely.
Like, would just say, for example, Lucas never sold to Disney. There was no Episode 7, and maybe there was no Star Wars Rebels, and it just sort of ended with the Clone Wars. There's not going to be any more Star Wars anymore. Would people give a fuck? I mean, it would always be there, but then it would be sort of like just a memory. Yeah. It'd be
it's a different.
Time.
That's a different.
It's Star Wars is a living thing, and that's why it still continues to be as popular as it is. That's why I think I need to do the same thing with me. If I have a show on TV, fuck it, killing it. Like, you look at like Anthony Bourdain, he's got several shows on TV, and you know his other businesses are doing great because of that. Whatever restaurants he has or whatever merchandise he sells, his books, whatever, it all services each other.
It's a portal into just to all those other endeavors.
But he's on TV all the fucking time.
Yeah, you can't not escape him.
That'll sell your restaurant, that'll sell this, you know, sort of thing. And yeah, I mean, marketing yourself as
a
personality.
I would love to have that.
I mean, you've always been a personality and, you know, you've sold yourself a little bit along with your art, either directly or indirectly.
Sometimes very directly.
It's hard to miss you, you know, sort of a thing. And, you know, it's cool. I mean, especially on those old, the Star Wars lines and stuff, like everybody wanted to see him.
There
you
was
know,
a circle around, and
now you got the hip hop trooper doing that.
Yeah. Everybody's stealing your shit.
He didn't. Nah, but the thing is, I don't know. I wouldn't call it stealing because I come into these conflicts a lot with people who do mashup stuff, and some of my competitors in the bootleg toy games sometimes are like, have arguments about, well, who ripped this off first? It's like, you know, if the basis of your artwork is saying taking cool thing A and cool thing B and putting them together to make cool thing C, anybody can stumble upon that combination. It doesn't necessarily have to be ripped off from somebody. Like Star Wars plus hip hop equals cool. I may have figured that out earlier,
sure,
but someone can figure that out on their own without having seen me do it,
right,
and it's just as legitimate, and he actually does it way better than me, so, I mean, he does it all the time.
How's that possible?
He does it all the time, and that's the thing. What works about that guy? And also, I didn't have social media at the time.
Right. I mean, that's changed everything, I guess, the whole way you promote yourself, and it's exhausting.
But the thing is, it works, too, because... You know, again, to use Hip Hop Trooper, he's got a lot of followings and he's successful because that's what he does. He's the Hip Hop Trooper. And almost everything on his Instagram is him in the costume, in the boombox, somewhere cool with someone famous or doing this and just showing his shit off. And he just keeps it going and going and going. And it's easy to get and understand and like. Whereas somebody else who's like myself, sometimes it's this thing, sometimes it's that. Oh, here's some picture of my face doing something weird. Oh, here's a song. It's like, it's a little more all over the place and it's not... You have to pay longer attention to it to sort of get what's cohesive about it.
Right. So, Suckadelic.com, right? This is the main place for us to find you.
You can find digital versions of my artwork and buy my stuff. You're not going to find me.
But yes. And there's links to your social media and shit on there. Like, is that's where everybody should go if they want to learn more about
you?
Most of my
updates and information goes through Instagram.
Gotcha.
That's the primary tool that I use to promote myself. I have, you know, email mailing lists if you want it that way.
I'm still on that shit. I've unsubscribed from I think every mailing list ever, but I still keep yours because it gives me the updates, you know.
That's cool.
You guys had the I Do Gay Empire, I Do One drop like the same day that the gay marriage was passed.
That was slick, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was nice. Very nice. But I sent that shit out. Like we retweeted it on our site and because I was like, this is perfect. Because everybody was so happy that day. I'm like, awesome. There's a fucking Star Wars gay toy thing happening too. Amazing.
It should have got more play than it did.
Yeah.
I need like a publicist or something.
That was one of like your big breakout ones was the Gay Empire, right? Like that. That was a big when that hit.
Yeah, I don't know if it necessarily got like a shitload of publicity, but at least it got me on the map as far as the designer toy world goes. Like Frank Kozik wrote about it on the Kid Robot blog, and that's kind of what like started the flame. And then this guy, DKE Toys, started purchasing them for me wholesale, and from that, and that's what got me started.
So Star Wars. Obviously, your main thing. What were the other shit that you were into? Like, Lands of the Lost, I know. Sleek Stacks, you're big into.
Lord of the Rings, you had the other album, the third album, right?
Right.
That was the second one, and it was the most terrible.
He-Man.
He-Man, all the classic stuff.
Yeah.
All the classic stuff, but...
Where's your end point? Like, 85? Like,
pretty much,
around
yeah,
there?
Pretty
like,
much, yeah.
85 and before?
It really dovetailed quite cleanly with like when they stopped making Star Wars figures. Like I guess the Power of the Force stuff was like 85,
right.
Droids 86, but by then I was into smoking pot.
That's what happens with
but it was just seemed like just the timing was right because I was there at the right age in 78 to get all to just get that first wave golden era of Star Wars. And then right when that ended, I was at the right age to start taking psychedelics.
Right.
And I started getting into all those things, you know, the other things that influenced me, politics.
Sure.
Spirituality. Politics, spirituality, you know, punk rock, hip hop.
Right.
All that kind of other stuff that also influences me. And all those things now somehow blend together.
Right. Because, if I look around, it's always, there's no, like, Transformers or no, like, fucking Ninja Turtles or
I fuck
any
with
of
Transformers,
that shit.
To be honest,
you've had
with
some
you.
Megatron stuff, I feel
yeah,
like, I
the,
remember.
All my Wall Street critiques go with Transformers.
Right.
You know, I did the Occupy Cybertron thing.
That's right. I remember like that. Yeah.
Using the Decepticons as the 1%ers and the Autobots as the 99%. And I actually were able, I was able to put that on a television show as well. We were on another Bravo show called Gallery Girls, which was, they were trying to do like the Real Housewives of the Lower East Side. It was their attempt to sort of take the art thing from Work of Art and mix it with the car crash shit. Wasn't a huge success, but I managed to get on there, and we my toys was a little subplot in one of the episodes, and that was great for business.
Yeah.
And so all that stuff, which is from like 78 to 85, which is sort of the basis, has it been more difficult to find materials and things like that? Like the shit you want to do? Because loose figures you can always find.
Tons of it. Tons
and like if you're looking for something in the package, it might be difficult. Yeah,
but, no, but I'm generally not.
Right.
The,
of course not.
Loose and busted. I have been using, I've been incorporating the, some of those Funko reaction figures into it now as well.
Oh, yeah.
Like that Joe Camel. Uh-huh. Figure over there. It's the head of a Playmobil camel, and the body is Harvey Keitel from Pulp Fiction. If it works, I'll use it. It doesn't have to be a vintage piece. I prefer the vintage stuff.
Sure.
But I'll use anything as long as it serves the purpose.
Because, yeah, loose toys, you can always find
where
loose
do you,
toys.
Well, where do you get them? Do you get them online or do you get them in?
Pretty much. Yeah. I could buy. It depends. Sometimes people will just literally hit me up out of nowhere and saying, I'm cleaning out my basement at my mom's house and I have all these toys. Do you want it? And I always say yes. Yeah. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's there's a one gold piece in a box of bullshit, but get it that way. Or flea markets or
used to be probably a lot of flea markets and digging through bins and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, I love doing that stuff. Yeah, yeah. I mean, if I'm walking down anywhere and I see a bin of toys, I'm gonna drop to my knees and start digging. Yeah. But
all right, this is a dumb question, but
I'm sure
they all have been, but what is it when you see something that makes you say this is a gold piece? Like, can you describe it, or is it just a feeling, or, you know, what is it?
Just something that I know is just has a lot of appeal. There's just some things that are inevitably badass. I mean, whatever, you get a box. This is probably a stupid example, but say someone sends me a box of 3 3/4 inch figures and 95% of it is like 95, you know, bulked up, muscly Star Wars figures. Right. I'm going to be like, fuck this. But if there's like a vintage Boba Fett in there, I'm like, oh, okay, well, this I could definitely do something with. This will never get uncool.
Yeah.
And I can always find a place for this that it's going to sell. Things like that. I don't mean like holy grails of things that are worth money, but just like, you know, there's certain things that just have certain cachet that are always going to be cool.
There are these, I've noticed the muscle figures. You've sort of been doing versions of those quite a bit.
This is actually something that we do manufacture overseas in a factory. These are the suckle things.
I love it.
And they're clearly derivative of the muscle things.
Right.
The Keshi figures, is that what they're? Keshi figures.
Is that the real?
Yeah,
the original name, yeah.
And a guy I know that supports my efforts was willing to help me do this, and we did a Kickstarter. And
simply unimportant, collectible, kitschy little eyesores. I dig it.
The acronym is different in series 2, which is coming out soon. We did this on Kickstarter. Pretty cool. And this is great because they're only $2. And nobody has an excuse not to spend $2.
Right.
And it's, yeah, they're great, especially when you do like a merch table or something like that. You can sell them all fucking day. Right. And have something to
everybody
show
loves
for.
And those muscle figures resonate too. There's like a whole generation that is fucking into those things.
And also it's just another way to put the brand forward. Like maybe somebody's not willing to spend $45, $75, $150 on a Sucklord figure, but you can buy a $2 Sucklord figure, and now there's one more person walking around in the world who has the Sucklord occupying a couple of pixels in their brain. And
what was the muscle acronym?
Potential.
I have no idea.
That's a good. Somebody must know that in the
You've
interwebs.
Got a computer in front of you.
It's cheating. Okay. I don't really care that much.
I'm ashamed that I don't know that.
Yeah. The King Kong ones I noticed you've been doing of late too, which I think are really cool.
Easy. You know, it's just these are iconic things. Even the Cylon
football players. I fucking love.
I just feel like okay. I'm starting to get to the point where, like, I have my 10 guys. You know, I have Boba Fett, Stormtrooper, Creature from the Black Lagoon, Frankenstein, King Kong, Megatron, Sleestak, and a couple of others. And I just say, I'm just going to put these guys in as many different other situations as possible. Yeah. Like, I'm doing them all as cowboys this year. This year has been the Suckadelic West. So I just
get the old
cowboy figures, mash those guys up with the body, and then go and find some archetypical Western shit, which is, there's so much of it, everything from like the gritty you know, Clint Eastwood movies to like the goofy Howdy Doody stuff and Gunsmoke and Wanted posters. There's just the endless. Cobra Commander is another one. Yeah. Endless.
Yeah, I see the cowboy. Yeah.
Endless, you know, cowboy mythology to have to play with. So just putting these guys in that situation is fun for me, and people seem to like it.
I think that's great. Like, have like a established cast of characters that you just put into different genres and time zones and whatever, and toy lines and stuff is fucking awesome.
It is awesome.
Yeah. What I try to do, though, I know a lot of people do this stuff, and where I think they don't succeed is they don't get the 2+2=3 thing. It's like some people will take Frankenstein and mix him with Boba Fett and call it Frankenfett. And that's looks cool, but it's still not quite there. It's like, I don't like that's, I used Cobra Commander for this figure. I made him into like a sort of, you know, but I called him the Mass Marauder, you know, whether that's creative or not, it doesn't matter, but it's not like Cobra Commander cowboy. It's like, I want it to be slightly abstracted a little bit. So the, you know, it's clearly the reference is there, but it's put into a slightly different context and hopefully becomes its own thing.
Very cool. Yeah. Well, we'll look forward to that. To the Western line. Is this the only one that's out so far?
No, I did. There's the creature one. This was the second one. Then I did the High Plains Drifter Fett. And then there was the Slee Stack, like, TV cowboy. And then the next one is going to be Frankenstein. And I'm combining Frankenstein with High Noon.
Excellent.
And then after that, there's going to be a Megatron cowboy.
Cool. What was the creature one?
His name was Garth Greengills, and it was called Branded Outlaw. And it was just, I had this really cool wood grain paper that I wanted to use. So I used that as the background, and I printed on it, and I used this sort of brownish black, and it looked like it was kind of branded onto the wood.
If you do another one of those, the creature is one of my absolute favorites.
Next one, I'm going to do all the gay Leathermen.
Ah.
So you can buy the creature Leatherman, along with Smegatron.
Excellent. All right. Well, I think it'll wrap it up for this one.
Cool.
We're going to have a part two with the Sucklord. We're going to really jump into Star Wars and talk about our history of Star Wars and our Star Wars fandom and what's coming forward. But this will wrap it up for this. Thank you very much, Amit, for joining us.
Thanks.
Sucklord.
Thanks for the $4,000 check for doing it.
Thanks for so much. Check us out at ccd.nyc for all information about other events that we're doing, other podcasts, live events. Videos, and all our social media links are on there. All right, thanks so much once again, boys.
Check me up at Sucklord on Instagram.
Sucklord on Instagram, suckadelic.com. From the Suckhole. See you later, boys.
Later.
Thanks so much.